Hello everybody, I'm Owen, and today I'm going to read you the book, Chapter 5, South Sea Adventure. Chapter 5, Giant Sea Bats. Bats, cried Roger the next morning from his perch in the crow's nest. I see bats as big as barn doors. That sounded silly even to Roger. Bats don't swim, and bats never are as big as barn doors. And yet, these were certainly that big, and they were swimming along the surface, with their great black wings rising and falling. Roger was official announcer. He spent much of every day in the crow's nest, watching the sea. His sharp eyes had spotted many interesting specimens. When he saw anything, he could call out, and the ship would change course if necessary to come up with it. If it proved to be something that Hull wanted, an effort would be made to net it and add it to the collection. The captain would put the wheel over the spoke or two and headed for the school of black, flapping monsters. Hull came tumbling up below with a pair of binoculars. He could not believe what he saw through them. "What are they?" he asked Captain Ike. "Sea bats. Some of them call it devilfish." It came to Hull that his was one of the specimens of his father's important slant especially wanted. It was a manta, a giant ray. How could they hope to capture one? And would the biggest tank be enough to hold it? The mantas were going around in circles, eventually pursing small fish as the lively lady came nearer. All on the board could plainly see what went on. Fixed their attention, especially to the one monster close by. It was turning in a tight circle, one wing above water and the one wing under. It was fully 20 feet across wing tip to wing tip. It was about 18 feet long from mouth to tail. It was chasing a school of mullet. On each side of its mouth was a great flat flipper or arm. These arms spread out, gathering in fish, and shoveled them into the monster's mouth. And what a mouth! It was 4 feet wide, big enough to swallow two men at one gulp. But Hull knew that the giant ray was not a man-eater. It preferred fish. It was extremely dangerous just the same. It had been known to leap in the air and bring down its two-ton weight upon a small boat, smashing it to kindling wood and killing its occupants. Its white black tail could cut through a knife. Sometimes, instead of falling upon the boat, the giant ray would come up beneath it, lifting it clear out of the water and then upsetting it. It might then thrash about among the swimmers, killing or maiming them. It had no fear of man. Perhaps it was too stupid to fear him. Perhaps it was too confident of its own great strength. It would sometimes accompany small boat for miles, swimming under it and around it and leaping over it. If the boatmen beat it with the oars, it didn't seem to mind. The blows did not disturb it any more than a tap of the ribs would hurt a man. Once a man had fallen overboard into the gray open mouth of a devilfish. The creature eventually did not like the taste and disgustingly spat him out. The man was unhurt except for a bad scratch of the monster's lower teeth. The captain brought the ship up in the wind and crawled slowly into the middle of the school. There was a ship that came to stand still, sails flapping idly. On every side, huge black wings were lifting and dropping. Mantas eventually liked company. They usually traveled in packs. Hull could count 28 of them in this school. Captain Ike grinned at Hull, who looked at the picture of bewilderment. "Well, here we are. What do you want to do?"
"I want to get one of those alive,"
the captain snorted.
"You'll never do that, son. We could get one of them dead, but not alive. We could harpoon one."
"That won't do," said Hull. Then he came out of the trance and began to issue orders. "Roger and Omo, go below and get that net. Crab, launch the dinghy. Captain, keep her in stays. We'll never be here before sometimes." Captain Ike began to show real worry.
"What are you doing?"
"Going to get one of those big fellow. We'll stretch the net between the dinghy and then the ship so he'll run into it."
"You crazy fool," began the captain.
But Hull was not listening. One lead of the heavy net was made fast so the capstan on the deck of the lively lady, the net dropped into the dinghy, and Hull, Roger, and Omo let themselves down into the small boat. They rowed away from the ship, letting out the net as they went.
When the net was all digging about 50 feet from the ship, they let off the net and made so fast mooring bits in the digging. The circle that the big fellow was making should bring him right into the net. Just what would happen then, nobody dared guess. Around came the sea bat. It ignored the boat. It looked far larger and more terrifying than he had the deck of the ship. The upper net of projected from the water. The devilfish seemed to be sensed that there was some obstruction ahead of him, but instead of slowing down or swimming to one side, he came faster and faster and faster until he was going like a speedboat. Then he suddenly came clear out of the water and soared through the air. He crossed 10 feet above the net, looking like a flying barn door carried away by the cyclone. Hall reminded of a North Trip flying wing. Then he hit the water on the other side of the net with the sound of report of a 5-inch naval gun. He came plunging around and again in another circle. His excitement seemed to be transferred into the other mantas, and then they began to leap out of the water, coming down again with terrific smacks. Some of them turned complete somersaults, and their big white bellies gleaming in the sun. Curiosity was bringing them closer to the small boat. "They're ganging up on us," cried Roger. Hall began to believe that the captain was right. Only a crazy fool could have put himself into two companies in the way of 28 devilfish. This time, it was another manta that approached the net. Instead of leaping over it, it turned sharply away and towards the small boat. Suddenly, fighting the boat in its way, it leaped into the air. The boys were sudden cut off from the sunshine by the flying cloud. Hall crouched low, fearing the terrible crushing smash of the monster's weight. Roger had a better idea and slipped under the thwart. Omo, belonging to a race that accepts life or death calmly, sat smiling. As the devilfish came down with a terrific crack on the other side of the boat, only its razor tail failed to clear the boat and cut a deep gash in the gunwale. Another manta was examining the boat with great interest. It gave a crack with one of its powerful arm-like fins. If it had struck hard enough, it could have smashed the boat, as if it was splintered at the top strike on the port side, but fortunately the plank was above the waterline and no leak to result. Then it circled the boat and ran into the net. "We've got him!" cried Call. "If he doesn't back out," said Roger. "I think that they're just one-way fish. They can't back." Certainly, the manta was not attempting to go backward, but it was trying to bore its way straight through the obstruction. It managed to get one arm through and then the other. It turned on the edge tail and slipped through the meshes. Once in, it did not come out, and easily, since the tail was covered with sharp spikes, it acted like as fish hooks. "Row!" shouted Hall, and two pairs of oars and paddle propelled the boat forward and toward the ship. Thus, the net began to close on the giant ray, but it was not one surrendered easily. It threshed about buoyantly, churning the sea in whirlpools and setting up gestures of water properly soaking the boatmen. The boat began to settle under the gallons of water that were splashed into it. It was lucky that the line from the net had been made fast to the mooring bit, so for no men or man who could held it. The tugs on the line jerked the boat here and there, many times nearly upsetting it. Now the boat was under counter of the schooner. But the captain was leaning over the rail and his eyes popping. "Quick, throw me the line!" Hall pulled the line free and bits of heaved into the captain, who caught it deftly and ran to make it fast to the capstan. Now the both ends of the net were secure to the captain's. The giant sea was in its pocket, from which were there little chance of escape. Crab was swinging the cargo boom. It was hinged into the mansfat, and from its seaward it hung into a great hook. Hall mashed the hook to the net. The schooner's engine began to whir, and the net with its worthing contents started upward. A cheer broke from the boys in the dinghy, but it cheered too soon. A conflict struggle, the manta failed with arms, ending wings, and tail. One of these flying appendages caught the boat and meshed it and stove it as if it had been an eggshell. The boys found themselves in the water and made all haste to swim clear out of the churning devilfish. The captain threw out a line, and Hall and Roger climbed aboard. They looked back to see that Omo had been struck by the monster's razor-edged tail and was lying in the water, stunned and bleeding. Sharks, instantly attracted by blood, were closing onto him. Hall drew his knife and was about to leap back into the sea when Captain said, "Don't do it. You won't want a chance." And Crab growled, "Let him sink. He's only a Kyanna anyhow." It was all Hall needed. Boiling with rage over Crab's callous words, he dived into the blood-tinged sea, not forgetting to take the end of Captain's line with him. He looped around Omo's chest, meanwhile keeping up a living splash to make passes with inquisitive sharks with his knife. Omo was hauled aboard. Hall fended off sharks until the line came again. Then he lost no time gaining safety of the deck. Omo came to life just enough to open one eye and say, "Thanks!" Then he closed his eye and submitted in silence while Hall dressed the painful wound. "Here goes a good dinghy," said Captain Ike ruefully, looking at the splinters floating about in the foam whipped up by the whirling mass of furry in the net. "Hoist away," he cried, and up, up, up went the struggling sea bat. Its teeth and spines cut in net a dozen places, but the net was made of inch-thick hemp cables and enough to hold until it's captive and have been brought over the tank to lower into it. Hall was glad to see that the tank was just big enough to hold its huge guest, but the visitor did not like its new home and proceeded to splash all the water out of the tank. The pump was turned and more water poured in it. The crew struggled to get the leg on the tank for it, and quite seemed likely that the Magneta would leap clear out of its prison and thrash about the decks, demolishing spars and ridging. The lid or hatch was finally locked in place. Then all crowded around the glass porthole to get a look at the prize. It had given up the fight and lay quietly on the bottom of the tank like an immense black blanket. The net was still draped about. "How will we get the net out of there?" Roger wanted to know. Hall had no taste for another bout of his unwilling guest. "We'll leave him in the net. That way, it'll be possible to lift him out of there. We ought to make Hulunu a couple of days now. We'll transship him to cargo streamer bound for home. Then we'll have the tank free in case we want another big passenger. An octopus, maybe?" hoped Roger. "Maybe, but in the meantime, Roger, you are appointed to chief to Mr. Manta. You've got to get enough fish to keep him full and happy. And no dinghy for fish from," mourned Roger. Then his eyes brightened. "I think I know how to catch just enough fish for His Majesty." When night came, the fish began to pour on board. Roger had just adjusted a chort and threw a big bright light on sail, and it brought flying fish by the dozen. When enough had accumulated to make a good meal, Roger and Omo gathered them and dumped them into the tank, where they speedily disappeared down into the mighty maw of the sea bat. All right, everyone, we've hit chapter 6, Coral Atoll. See you next time. Bye!